Hello, this is Pastor Paul from Friendship, and we are so delighted to have you in our online community today for the wonderful worship we're about to experience as we talk about true love today. And I hope you see behind me the sign that says, "Will you marry me?" That's something you need to be sure and listen for as we go through the message. So don't miss it. Be sure to take your Bible or Bible app and join us in the Old Testament book of Ruth, chapter 3, as we get ready for that. Now, we're about to experience some great worship together, but before that, I want to tell you about a very special mission project. Friendship Baptist Church was founded 30 years ago, and one of the things that we have always felt was important was to be on mission for Jesus. And one of the ways we're doing that right now is through a project called Appalachian Backpacks. And what we're doing is we are sending backpacks to boys and girls and young teenagers in the poorest and neediest areas in the United States of America, the Appalachian region. Now, it's important that we send these backpacks. We fill them with love and lots of goodies. In fact, in each of the backpacks, there is a list of items that we want to make sure are included in each backpack. So what we'd like to ask you to do is to come be a part of this project with us. Last year, we donated over 300 backpacks to those needy children and teenagers in Appalachia. And with your help, we'll even have more than that this year. Here's how it works. You can come by the church, or you can be here on Sunday and request from one of our helpers a backpack, fill it up, bring it back to us by the end of July, and that backpack will go to someone that needs it desperately. This backpack is a ticket out of poverty. It's a ticket out of a hard situation in a drug culture that is consuming the people in Appalachia. Make a difference. Every time a backpack is given, the gospel is shared so that that person has an opportunity to know that Jesus Christ died on the cross for their sins, has a special purpose and plan for their life, just like you know about that. We are so glad that you want to be a part of this project. And you say, "Well, I'd love to be a part, but I don't want to go shopping." Well, you can donate $30 to this project, and we'll do the shopping for you and fill it up, and you'll still make a difference in the life of a child or teenager. Thank you for being with us today. Now, let's worship the Lord together.
Shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. I nothing lack if I am his, and he is mine forever. So he leadeth, and where the verdant pastures grow, with fruit celestial feedeth. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul, on the mountain high, or in the valley low, the King of love, my shepherd. Off I strayed, but yet in love he sought me, and on his shoulder gently laid, and home rejoicing brought me. In death's dark veil I fear no ill, with you, dear Lord, beside me. Thy rod and staff my comfort still, before to guide me. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul. The King of love, my shepherd is. The King of love, my shepherd is. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul, on the mountain high or in the valley low, the King of love, my shepherd is. Never failing, ruler of my heart, everlasting, lover of my soul, on the mountain high or in the valley low, the King of love, my shepherd. Thy goodness faileth never. Good shepherd, may I sing your praise within your house forever. Within your house forever.
Chuck Swindoll tells the story of a young woman who was talking to someone about wanting to get married, and she said, "Yes, sir. I've made up my mind that I want to get married to four men in a certain order during my lifetime." She said, "I first want to marry a banker. Then, my second marriage, I want to be to an actor. My third marriage, I want to be to a preacher of all people. And my fourth marriage, to a funeral director." I said, "Well, why in the world would you pick those four and in that order?" She said, "Well, it's one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready, and four to go." During my lifetime, I have seen so many changes in the way people look at love and marriage and the home. And it breaks my heart to see the changes that I've seen just in my lifetime, let alone in just the last 10 years or so. You have so many that have this idea that they don't want commitment. They don't want responsibility. They just want the fun part. But I have good news for you. How many of you have been married for 50 years or more? Wow, that is awesome. Give the Lord a hand for that commitment. That is awesome. I am so thankful for you. I know Miss Pat and Brother Marley celebrated their 42nd, I believe, this week. So marriage is wonderful. I'm 32 and a half years in and never been happier in my life. Best 32 and a half years of my life. And I'm thankful for that. But today we have a lot of people that walk away from those commitments. And then we have some that remain in the commitments, but they are just so empty and they are just so miserable and they are just stressing their way through it. And then you have those who are fully committed and fulfilled in that relationship. And no matter what happens and the roads that may beset them, they are just so in love and committed to being husband and wife. It's a beautiful thing. We come to the book of Ruth here and we see a story about love that is blossoming. It is literally blossoming in the lives of Boaz and Ruth here. And you can look at the actions of Boaz and Ruth and you can see what begins to unfold in them as we see true love come into view here. Only the hardened and the bitter among us remain untouched by something called love. Yes, love is possible, but we need to realize that love is not just an emotion, it's an act of the will. And whether it's the love of God, or whether it's our love for one another, or the love that you have between a child, a parent, or even a husband and wife, it is love of the will. So we come now to a beautiful story in chapter 3 of Ruth. It's the story of human love. And then we find here also that we are in a series of messages that I have entitled Hope, Love, and redemption. And this third message in that series today comes to us as we look at the subject of true love in Ruth. That's right, true love in Ruth. While we can feel the love and we can also see some things that we need to beware of when we're in pursuit of love. So under the veneer of this true love story, we're going to see also the parallels that come in our divine love story, our relationship with God. We're going to look today at three principles that will help us when we think about true love. If you're going to experience true love, there needs to be these three things: patience, integrity, and thoughtfulness. God wants us to be people of patience, integrity, and thoughtfulness. And so let's take God's word in Ruth chapter 3. Please stand if you're able. And let's look at the first five verses in Ruth chapter 3. Then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said unto her, "My daughter, shall I not seek rest for thee, that it may be well with thee? And now is not Boaz of our kindred, with whose maidens thou wast? Behold, he winnoweth barley tonight in the threshing floor. Wash thyself therefore, anoint thee." In other words, put on your best dress, get yourself bathed, and put on the finest perfume you've got. "And get thee down on the floor to the floor, but make not thyself known unto the man until he have done eating and drinking." Verse 4, "And it shall be when he lieth down that thou shalt mark the place where he shall lie, and thou shalt go in, uncover his feet, and lay thee down, and he will tell thee what thou shalt do." And she said unto her, "All that thou sayest unto me, I will do." Ruth says, "I don't have a clue what you do in your culture here in Bethlehem. Doesn't make any sense to me, but whatever you say to do, I'll do it, because you know it and I don't." So here we go. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you and I praise you for your faithfulness, your goodness, your gentleness, your kindness. But Lord, today we want to learn more about true love. Father, help us to understand the behaviors, the characteristics, the things that ought to be alive and well within us if we are experiencing true love in our relationship with you and our relationship with others, our relationships in our households, or our relationships with those across the street. Father, help us to understand what you would teach us and to understand the principles of true love in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Thank you. Be seated. We see, first of all, in the first 9 verses, that true love requires patience. Everyone say patience with me. Your ability to walk in wisdom is only as good as your ability to surround yourself, hear me now, with wise advisors. Now, I will tell you that Naomi is not a picture of a wise advisor. She is a very unwise advisor in the advice that she gives to him. In fact, unwise advisors can get you in a lot of trouble, a big hot mess, if you will, if you're not careful. So the first scene here in the first 5 verses of Ruth chapter 3 show us indeed that Naomi is an unwise, matchmaking busybody. And this mother-in-law is not seeking God. She's not prayed about that which she tells Ruth to do. In fact, she's just going off on her own doing what she thinks is best, not what God thinks is best. And you may say, well, you're being pretty hard on this woman, don't you think? Well, I am probably, but I know this. Her heart was good in some ways. I know this because she wanted Ruth to have a redeemer. She wanted Ruth to have a husband. She wanted Ruth to have a happy home. She wanted all that, and that's a good thing, amen? But on the other hand, even though she had good intentions, she had some problems swirling around what she wants to do. The first problem was that Naomi was not patient in seeking God on Ruth's behalf. She wasn't seeking God on Ruth's behalf. She was winging it. You know what? You ever meet anybody that flies by the seat of their pants? I mean, they don't know what they're doing 10 minutes from now, so they just kind of, you know, whatever comes in their head, they're spontaneous, and just whatever comes up comes out, and that's just the way they are. Well, Naomi was a lot like that. She wasn't waiting on God. She wasn't counting on the providence of God to work these things out. She was still trying to figure out, just like she was in the beginning of Ruth chapter 1, when she and her husband Elimelech took their two boys, Malan and Chilion, left Bethlehem because they were kind of on some hard times and went 40 miles downhill to a place of bad stuff. They went to a place where they didn't need to be. And, of course, you know the story, as we've already told in the first two messages, bad things happen as a result of that. And the reason why was because they weren't listening to God. They didn't have the patience to wait on God. Patience is important. Say that with me. Patience is important. Naomi thinks she can jump into the middle of this, force a solution, and everything will work out just fine. Thank you very much. Bye. That's kind of her attitude. She tries to set up a proposal between Ruth and Boaz, thinking that the end will justify the means of how she got there. Have you ever heard the end justifies the means? Well, the end that she arrives at is not justified by the means she used to get there. In the process, Naomi gives Ruth horrible advice. But it's not just Naomi. This isn't anything new. You can go all the way back to the book of Genesis and you can find Abram and Sarai. You remember Abram and Sarai? We know that God had promised them that they were going to have a child, and a lot of time went by. This thing went on for almost 25 years. And so they had a child. So along and along as they were going towards those 25 years, Sarai decided, you know, I better help out God here. I think He's forgotten. You know, I think he's neglected. I think the Lord just needs some help here. So I'm going to do this. I'm going to take my handmaid, Hagar, and I'm going to let her have a relationship with my husband, Abram. And since we obviously aren't going to have a child, I'll let them have a child and everything will be good and God will be happy about this. Of course, I'm not going to pray about it. I'm not going to ask God what He thinks. I'm going to just do it because that's what I think we ought to do. Well, we know what kind of mess that got Abram and Sarah in. In fact, if you go to the Middle East and you see the conflict between the Arabs and the Israelis, do you know where that came from? That came from a really bad decision that Sarai made way back then. So once God did provide for them through Isaac and what we know as the children of Israel, We see that Abraham and Sarah, as their names came to be, worked it out okay, but it was because God worked in it. It didn't have anything to do with what Sarai did in her selfish ways because she was impatient with God. Be careful. Now, we don't need to think that it stopped back in the Old Testament or even the New Testament. A lot of us are impatient with God, aren't we? We know what we want, we know when we want it, we know how we want it, and so thank you very much, God. Here's how you're going to do it. And if you don't do it pretty quick, I'm going to do it for you. And we have that attitude, and it gets us in a mess, and then we spend months and years and lots of money usually trying to dig our way out of a hole that we shouldn't have dug in the first place. We should have waited on God to dig the hole, because He would have not dug us a hole, He would have built us a stairway to heaven. God's timing is always best, and His plans are always better than ours. Amen? Yes, they are. When we try to rush God's plan, all we're going to do is rush into danger. Now, that was the first problem she had. Now, the second problem that Naomi has is she tries to push Ruth too far, too fast. Naomi tells her, you get in there and you put your best dress on, you put all that fancy perfume on, and you get you a good bath, and then here's what you do. You go on down there tonight to where Boaz is at. He's going to be down at the threshing floor. You go down there and you wait until he's come in. He's had his supper and he's all ready for bed. And you go in there and you mark your spot and you get down there at his feet. And then what does verse 7 say? Listen to this. Well, let's go to verse 4. The instruction that she gave her said, and thou shalt go in and uncover his feet. Say that with me. Uncover his feet. Now, in that day, now uncover his feet, you say, well, that's nothing. That's really nothing. Well, basically, it means partially unclothe him. Let's put that in Middle Georgia English for 2020. And so it's going to show his legs, if you will. So this, she's wanting her to be seductive, if you will, to accomplish the task that she's wanting to see accomplished. So Ruth is obviously naive. You say, wait a minute, how could she be naive? Wasn't Ruth married previously? Yes, she was married, but it was in a different culture. We're in Bethlehem now. Ruth doesn't know what the cultural traditions, what the protocols are, all those things. So she's relying on Naomi to shoot her a straight shot and lead her in the right direction. The only problem is Naomi's not. Naomi's trying to write a hot little love story here and not do it the way God would have her to do it. So here we see in verses 6 through 8. In fact, let's read verses 6 through 8 and let's see how this unfolds as Ruth does what Naomi told her to do. It says in verse 6, "And she went down under the floor and did according to all that her mother-in-law bade her. And when Boaz had eaten and drunk, and his heart was merry, and he went to lie down at the end of the heap of corn." You see, back in those days, if you were harvesting your crop and you were at the threshing floor, you didn't just do what you needed to do till sundown and then go back to your house, because if you did, you might not have any left in the morning because somebody would come in and steal all your stuff. So what they would do is you'd make a pallet and you would sleep where your heap of grain was. That way if somebody tried to mess with it, you'd wake up and clobber them, you know? So that was that's kind of the story of how that would go. So here we come in verse, it says, she came softly in verse 7. She came softly and uncovered his feet and laid her down. And it came to pass at midnight that the man was afraid and turned himself, and behold, a woman lay at his feet. So he wakes up at midnight, and you know, you ever wake up in the middle of the night and you're kind of disoriented? It takes you a second to remember where you're at and how you got there or something. You know, ever at? I'm the only one. Okay, wow. So here we come to verse 9, and in verse 9, we see something very odd happen. He said, verse 9, "Who art thou?" Well, he had met Ruth before. He knew she was, but again, it's the middle of the night, got to get your bearings straight, all is figured out. And she answered, "I am Ruth, thy handmaid." And then she says, following her mother-in-law's unwise, ungodly instructions, "Spread therefore thy skirt over thine handmaid, for thou art a near kinsman." You know what she just did? She just said, "Will you marry me?" She proposed to Boaz in this way. You see, the law of that day allowed for the fact that in the event that someone's husband died, and her husband had died, Ruth's husband had died, that she could marry a near kinsman. And that's how the law was set up. You can go back and read that in Deuteronomy. But there it is. It was how it was set up that would take place a certain way. And so that was how it was supposed to be. There's going to be some complications with that. There's going to be some problems with that. But it reminds us, though, that Jesus is waiting to save us. He is our Redeemer. Here, He is our nearest kinsman. He is the only one who can meet the need for us, and He's waiting for us to come to Him. And that's the picture we have here. The reality of salvation is it's free. It won't be forced upon us. We've got to desire it. There's a warning here, though. For all of you mature adults, for all you folks who've been Christians a while, you know that you're supposed to rely upon God. Amen? You know that you're supposed to seek God's counsel, you're supposed to seek God's wisdom, and you're supposed to be accountable for the advice. You know, anytime I ever counsel with someone, I always pray before I meet with them, at the beginning of that session when I meet with them, and I ask God to help me to be a really good listener and to give the words that He would have me to give, not that man would have me to give in relation to their problem. That's what I ask Him to do. Well, she has not prayed that prayer, I can promise you. So this thing could have gone from bad to worse in a New York minute because she wasn't doing what she was supposed to do. But I want to warn you, mature adults who are Christians, you have a responsibility. If you give godly counsel and they see you as a godly person or a Christian, you're accountable to God for what you tell them. You need to remember that because it is a big deal. You may say, well, preacher, wait a minute. I've read the book of Ruth, and you've read the book of Ruth, and you know just as well as I do that when you get to the end of Ruth, that Boaz and Ruth are married, right? That's right. So what's the big deal? All's well that ends well. What's the problem? Well, the only reason it ended well was because the providence of God showed up and Boaz was a godly, worthy, responsible man who did the right thing. But what if Boaz had not? How differently this thing would have turned out. So, you know, God did bring good out of evil. God did bring good out of bad. But we don't need to take that for granted. We don't need to get ahead of God because, friends, true love requires patience. Say that with me. True love requires patience. Don't get ahead of God. You may have good intentions in mind. You may have even godly intentions in mind. But whatever you do, don't get ahead of God. Now, why wouldn't Naomi give Ruth these instructions? Well, it's very simple. She wanted the right thing. She wanted her to have a husband. She wanted her to have a home. That's a good thing. But the problem was, Naomi wants this thing on her terms. It'll be my way or the highway. Have you ever met anybody that wanted things their way or the highway? You need to run hard and fast from somebody like that, because if it has to be their way or the highway, it's going to be a problem. Because the only way that it can happen is that person has to manipulate hard the circumstances that are around them. That's what they have to do in order to make it work out the way they want it to. So she felt like she had to do this thing by herself, her way, and in a worldly way instead of a godly way. And if it wouldn't have been for God moving in and Boaz saying and doing what he did, this thing would have ended up in a tremendous disaster and we wouldn't have had the book of Ruth. So that brings us to the second thing. Not only does true love require patience, but secondly, true love requires integrity. Everybody say integrity. Boaz woke up late at night, beautiful woman at his feet. Wow, how amazing is that? So what's he going to do? Well, let's go to verse 10 and see. Verse 10 says, "And he said, Blessed be thou of the Lord, my daughter, for thou hast showed more kindness in the latter than at the beginning, inasmuch as thou hast followed us not, young men, whether poor or rich." You know what he did? He said, he looked at Ruth and he said, "Ruth, I want the Lord to bless you." Wow. He's put God in this thing. I mean, what about the perfume? And what about uncovering his legs? And what about all these things that Naomi had told her? Hey, Boaz had to stand up and be a godly man, didn't he? He had to be a man of integrity, and that's exactly what he did. He put the brakes on immediately, and he brought God into the situation. Friend, God knew that Boaz knew that if God was going to bless Ruth, he was going to have to make a right decision here. He was going to have to do the right thing, and so he was going to have to treat her honorably, and that's exactly what he did. Hey, ladies, I don't care what age you are, if you're a teenager, if you're a young lady, or if you've never married, and no matter what your age is, or maybe you're a widow or divorced and whatever your situation is, I want you to remember something about guys. And I can say this because I am one, okay? So I got permission. If a guy has your best interests at heart, he will want God to bless you. And if he wants God to bless you, then if he claims to like you, love you, or want to be in your life or be with you, then he's not going to ask you to do things to dishonor God to get what he wants. Hello? Is this on? If they just want to sleep with you or they just want to shack up with you for what they can get out of the relationship without a marriage commitment, that person doesn't have your best interests at heart. You may say, "Oh, well, but he loves me, or she's wonderful. She's this and he's that." I don't care. Keep God at the center of your relationship. That's what Boaz did in verse 10. He put God right in the middle of that thing. It was hard to do the wrong thing if God was in the middle of it. Verses 11 and 12 go on to tell us that Boaz is careful to take all the right steps in a very diplomatic way. This guy should have been an ambassador to China or something. Watch this. This is cool. Verses 11 and 12. "And now, my daughter..." Now, this is Boaz talking to Ruth. Now, daughter means, you know what that means? He's older than she is. She's a younger woman. Wow. Here it is. I will do to thee all that thou requirest, for all the city of my people doth know that thou art a virtuous woman. You are a wonderful young lady. He tells her that. And he says, don't you worry about it. I know you need a kinsman redeemer, and I'm going to make sure that that happens for you one way or the other. I'm here to be your advocate, to help you. I'm going to be a blessing in your life. That's what Boaz tells Ruth. Verse 12, and now it is true that I am thy near kinsman, howbeit. Now the word howbeit in the King James is the word that we say but. Everybody say but. Anytime you see howbeit, nevertheless, or but, ooh, we got a problem. There's a problem. What's the problem? There is a kinsman nearer than I. Now, let's be very frank for just a second. Boaz is in love with Ruth. He thinks a lot of her. He's taken very kindly to her, and he would love nothing better than to be her husband. But his integrity causes him to do the right thing. He has information Ruth does not have. You know what that information is? That there is actually someone who, in the legal frame of thinking about things, is actually a little closer kin to her. So according to the law, everybody say law. According to the law, the nearest kinsman becomes the redeemer of that person. But they have to agree to be that person. So what you don't see in this part, but it's in there, is a conversation takes place, and the person who is most qualified to be that person under the law, everybody say law again, I'm going somewhere with this, that person has to make the decision. They have the first right of refusal. And guess what he does? He refuses. So when the law has been fulfilled, grace takes over. Everybody say grace. I'll take grace over law every day of the week. It's a beautiful thing. And so here, Boaz has integrity. That's one of the characteristics of love. I love what 1 Corinthians chapter 13, that's the love chapter of the Bible, by the way. In verse 7, it says this, that love or charity always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres, if you will. Boaz had that kind of love when he looked at Ruth. So verses 12 and 13 go on, and I've read verse 12, but I want you to read verse 13 as he knows he has an unusual problem. Here's what he tells her to do. Again, it's already midnight. It's already dark outside. There's lots of wild animals and people that mean no good that could attack her or worse. And so in verse 13, he says to Ruth, tarry this night. In other words, stay here. Uh-huh. There he goes. I thought you said he was a man of honor and integrity. Listen. And it shall be in the morning that if he will perform unto thee the part of a kinsman, in other words, this other guy who is closer kin to you than I am, well, in other words, that's fine. Let him do the kinsman's part. But if he will not do the part of the kinsman to thee, then I will. Because I'd really like to anyway. Yes, I'd like to marry you. Then I will do the part of the kinsman to thee, as the Lord liveth, but lie down until the morning. Wow. His godly integrity causes him to do the right thing for the right reason at the right time. Is godly integrity important? If it is, say godly integrity. Godly integrity. Verse 14. Don't miss this now. Verse 14. And she lay at his feet. Ruth lay at the feet of Boaz until the morning. And then notice what, did she sleep in till 10:30 or 11 o'clock, girls? No. She rose up before one could know another. In other words, she got up before everybody else. She got up super early. Wonder if she had one of those alarm clocks or how that happened. But. And he said, let it not be known that a woman came into the floor. Now, what was he do? What did he mean by that? Hey, I'm telling you, Boaz was protecting Ruth's reputation. And here's the thing that's the backstory that you may or may not realize. Back in that day, prostitutes were known for going at harvest time to the threshing floor and being there to entertain the men at night. And then people of town, people in town would see them leaving the threshing floor, heading back to their houses first thing the next morning, empty-handed. Get the picture? Boaz wants to protect Ruth's reputation. So he's about to do something that will help her and be a blessing to her. He wants to preserve her reputation and his own because he's a man of God. He's got a good reputation. He doesn't want to do anything. Don't throw your reputation away on something stupid, okay? Don't do it. Philippians chapter 2. You want a good verse of Scripture? There's actually two. Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4 says, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interest, but also to the interest of others." Boaz is absolutely interested in Ruth, but he is not interested in setting aside God's will to take up his interest in Ruth. Make sure you don't compromise God's will. Make sure you don't get ahead of God's will. And make sure that you don't just want some selfish benefit that's not part of God's plan just so you can have whatever it is you think you want. You might get more than you wanted and more than you bargained for and wish you could throw it back. Hello? If it's meant to be, God will work it out. Isn't that right? I believe that with all my heart. I have for years and years, and it's really true. If you'll go with me in the Old Testament book of Psalms, I love the Psalms, chapter 37, the first part of verse 7, you'll see these words, Psalm 37, 7. "Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him." That's some good advice. I don't care how you slice it. That's good advice. Rest in the Lord, wait patiently on Him. He'll figure this thing out for you. Then I also love the words of Isaiah chapter 30, verse 18. As we are to be patient with God and have integrity in our relationships, Isaiah 30, 18 will come to pass. Listen to this. "And therefore will the Lord wait, that He may be gracious unto you." Hey, if God doesn't keep your schedule, there's a reason God's not keeping your schedule. If God doesn't answer your prayer when you think He ought to answer the prayer, there's a purpose in His delay. Wait on Him. Have integrity enough and patience enough to wait on God. That He may be gracious to you. Hey, there's a blessing if you'll wait. Say that with me. There's a blessing if you'll wait. Then He says, "And therefore will He be exalted, that He may have mercy upon you, for the Lord is a God of judgment. Blessed are all they that," what? "Wait for Him." Boaz is a picture of what a Redeemer is. Jesus Christ is our ultimate Redeemer. He has put aside everything with integrity and patience and sacrifice. He has done everything. Remember this, true love requires integrity. But not only does true love require patience and integrity, but thirdly and lastly, true love requires thoughtfulness. Go down to verse 15 with me here in Ruth chapter 3. The Bible says, "And he said, bring the veil that thou hast upon thee, hold it." Now, so Boaz is telling Ruth, hey, bring me that veil. You know, it's a lot of cloth. It can hold a lot. And so he says, "Bring that here and hold it." And when she held it, he measured 6 measures of barley. Now, that's not those little teaspoon scoops. That's not what this is. This is a lot. Okay. "Measures of barley and laid it on her, and she went into the city." If you laid it on her, that meant that it weighed her down. Now, you see, Naomi's one of these. She's got a great plan, she thinks. And it's going to be to help somebody else, even though it's her own making. And then if it doesn't work out, if it falls apart, she's going to blame God or somebody else. That's what she did back in Ruth chapter 1. So here we're getting set up for another disaster. But Boaz accepts Naomi's weaknesses. He realizes what's going on here. And he accepts her graciously and kindly, and he takes responsibility, and he takes ownership. He doesn't say, hey, your mother-in-law's trying to mess your life up. He doesn't throw Naomi under the bus. Have you ever met people that like to throw other people under the bus? You don't have to do that. You don't have to throw somebody under the bus. Don't throw somebody under the bus. You ruin your testimony when you do that. Don't do that. Don't throw somebody under the bus. If they're all that bad, it's going to come out eventually. You let God take care of that. Hello? Let God take care of it. He'll take care of it. You don't have to throw him under the bus. He sends Naomi home with six scoops, which would be as much as that woman. And she's a hard-working young woman because she's been in the fields every day gleaning stuff. She's kind of bionic, if you would. But unless she had a gym membership at Golda's gym over there in Bethlehem, it was probably 80 pounds or so. That's a lot. So this way, he loads her down, and then what happens? And she went into the city. So remember, she's the first one out of bed. It's early in the morning. He's protecting her reputation, so he doesn't let her go back to home empty, back to town empty-handed, because folks will talk about her, you know, and say she's one of those women. Oh yeah, okay. So he makes sure that she's got this. Well, the message that is sent to anyone that passes her on the road on her way back home is what? Ooh, she must have worked hard yesterday. Must have worked well into the night. Must have gotten so tired she just fell asleep at the threshing floor, and now she's gotten her some rest. Now she's taken all that grain that she's got home. See, God will protect you too if you'll do things His way. God will make things which seem like they could end up bad turn out better than you would ever expect. But Boaz has another angle in mind here. Let's go on and read. She gets to her mom-in-law's house, Naomi's house. Wonder what happened. Here's what happened, verse 16. And when she came to her mother-in-law, she said, "Who art thou, my daughter? Are you Mrs. Boaz? Perhaps." Did he say, "Yes, I'll marry you"? What do we got here? And she told her all that the man had done to her, which wasn't exactly what Naomi thought she was going to come back and tell her. She thought she was going to tell her some juicier stuff than that. Verse 17, and she said, "These six measures of barley gave he me." What do you think of that, Naomi? "For he said to me, 'Go not empty unto thy mother-in-law.'" Well, Naomi might not have been a godly woman in the way she approached life, but she was a smart woman. She could add two and two, and she could get four in a New York minute. And here's what she figured out in verse 18. Then she said, "Sit still, my daughter." She's actually telling Ruth to be patient. Huh, that's like the pot calling the kettle black, isn't it? She has not been patient, but now she's telling Ruth to be patient. Why the change of heart? Let's see what's going on. Until thou know how the matter will fall. Just be patient until this thing's figured out. We'll know today what's going to happen. For the man will not be in rest until he have finished the thing this day. She gets it. She knew that Boaz was sending a dowry home. Now, I have two daughters, and neither one of my son-in-laws sent a dowry to our house. In fact, I had to do all the check writing. I'm the one that paid through the nose and everywhere else, you know, trying to get them married off. So, but it was fun. It was good. I'm not regretting that. But the thing of it is, here's what Naomi realized. Naomi realized Ruth had not done anything to earn all that grain. She didn't go out and glean it in the field. That was a gift from him to her mother-in-law. This was the dowry. And it was also meant to provide for her and meet her needs. You see, he's so thoughtful. Everybody say thoughtful. This is thoughtful. He's thoughtful for Ruth's reputation. That's why he sends her with the grain. He's thoughtful for Naomi and Ruth and their hunger needs being met. He's thoughtful in every way. Ruth may not have understood the significance, but Ruth did. After she saw it, she knew everything was going to be okay. Boaz was sending the message, true love is thoughtful. You see, Boaz wants Naomi and Ruth to trust God as much as he trusts God. Do you trust God as much as you should? If you don't, let today be a time of self-examination and say, "I want to trust God the way I should in every situation." Notice in verse 18 that Naomi gets the message. The big statement, the woman that said, "Hurry, hurry, hurry, off to Moab," is now saying, "Wait." Just slow down. It's good to know that you can rest in the arms of God until His will unfolds for your life. Not just for two widows, but for you. Right here, right now, on July 19th. God loves you. God cares for you. God's got a plan for your life. Don't get ahead of it, and don't lag behind. Stay right on track with Him. Ruth assures Naomi that she'll do what she's supposed to do, obviously. You see, it took the very life of Christ to redeem our sins. We were lost in sin. We were headed for a devil's hell, an eternal hell. But Christ did everything that was necessary to fulfill the requirements. If we can ever just get to the feet of Jesus, if we can ever just get to the foot of the cross, if we can ever just get to the point where we come to the end of ourselves and realize that Jesus is the only way, He is my Redeemer. I pray He is your Redeemer. And if He's not, I want you to know He wants to be. You know what true love is? True love is God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. That's true love. Sacrificial love. Sacrificial love. And when we show our true love with patience, integrity, and thoughtfulness, He will take care of all the details of our needs in our life. I love what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 to 33. He talks about all the things that God would take care of in our lives if we would just trust Him. And He ends it in verse 33 by saying this, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." You trust Me. You have patience with Me. You exercise integrity in your life. And you have thoughtfulness towards God and toward others. I will take care of you. I shall supply all your need. That's what Philippians 4:19 says. According to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Won't you trust God with every need in your life? There's a connection card just ahead of you. And it may be today that as we stand and sing in just a moment after we pray, that you may say, "Well, I would like to come and I'd like to publicly let folks know that I've accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior today. I know I need a Savior and today's the day." That's a great decision. But you may say, "But that's social distancing. I can't really come talk to you, preacher, the way I want to, one-on-one, just you and me right here. Can't really do it." Of course, that's what you want to do. That's what you need to do. But if you don't feel like you can do that, I want you to take that connection card. About halfway down, there's a little box that says salvation. I want you to check that box. I want you to put your name up at the top. You say, "That's my decision today. That's my commitment. I choose to follow Jesus. I want to be saved. I want to be a Christian. I want to be a believer." Maybe today that you say, "Pastor, I'm already a Christian. I've been saved for a long time. But what you've read out of the Scripture this morning, what you've shared this morning has touched a chord in me and helped me to realize that I'm not what I need to be. I need to be closer to the Lord. I need to be more committed to Him in my walk, in my faith. And I'm serious about that." Then under that, where it says comment or question at the bottom, I want you to write, "Recommit," and put your name up at the top. Or it may be today that you say, "You know, I've been looking for a Bible-believing, Christ-centered church for a while now, and I just found. I know this is where God wants me to be a member, where He wants me to serve the Lord and participate with you all. And so I want to know how to join this outfit." You can go right there in that block about middle ways down and check membership. We'll call you and talk with you about what that looks like and how that works. We'd love for you to be a part of this church family. You're not. So whatever your need is today, take that connection card, fill it out, again, because of the social distance, and I get it. And then when you take that out, you say, "What am I supposed to do with it then?" Well, in just a few moments after we're finished singing, I'm going to dismiss from the back row, and I'll be coming to your row so you can hand me that card, okay? Or if you'd rather not hand me the card, you want to be a little more anonymous than that, that's okay for right now. You can drop it in the box right by the library window there on the right where tithes and offerings are dropped. You can just put it right in there. That's fine. I'll get the card. And I'll get in touch with you sometime soon. Okay? I love you and I care about you. Don't miss God's plan for your life. Naomi almost made Ruth miss hers. You be sure you don't miss yours. Let's pray. Father, thank You. Thank You for the Word of God. Thank You for the time that we've shared in the Word. Thank You for the challenge. And now, Lord, our job is to come before you and be honest. Our job now is to respond to what we've heard. Lord, we're all responsible for that. What we choose to do is between us and you. I pray that we'll all make good decisions and good choices today. And I pray, Lord, that we'll have true love towards you. We'll exercise patience, integrity, and thoughtfulness. Lord, may we take that thoughtfulness and do something about it today. In Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, Amen.